Hello, my name is Daniel Biggs, and you're watching Valley Viewpoint, and it's going to be a special episode. With me tonight, I have Sierra from the county, who's in charge of the homeless, and also I have Nathaniel, who is a pastor at the First Congregational Church, and Kristen from the United Way. And they are making a difference in this community. They are all helping the homeless situation in Walla Walla. So, welcome, everyone.
Thank you.
Okay. So here's the situation. Just recently, I had heard that we have a warming center here in Walla Walla. And actually, I didn't know. And I did have some friends, and we have been going down to the homeless camp, and we've first went and brought them some sleeping bags and some items, some socks and hats and stuff, and then we started getting to know them and finding out what they needed, some food items, and they needed some fuel for the generators, and so we started, you know, understanding their needs and started bringing that to them. And it's just been such a terrible winter this year, so tough, and it's just heartbreaking to think that people are sleeping out. And I just want to get this off my chest. When I go out and see the people sleeping in this conditions, in these freezing cold conditions, and I go into my house after doing that, it's an awfully humbling thing. And it sure puts things in perspective quick. And I don't know if we know how thankful we need to be and how it just really touched me deeply to come home to a warm house, to a warm shower, and knowing that these people don't have that and they're out there in the cold. Went to the what happened is the warming center that is run at the First Congregational Church wasn't able to be open about a week ago, and that was because of a lack of volunteers. Okay, so I heard about this and I went and became a volunteer, and last night I had my first shift at the warming center, and it was a really great experience. It really was.
Good.
And
yeah, thank you.
It's just wonderful that you guys are providing this service. So anyways, that's a little preface to the story. And so, Nathaniel, can you tell us a little bit about yourself and a little bit about the warming center from your perspective?
Well, yes, thanks. I serve as the pastor at First Congregational Church, and I've been in that position for a year and a half. And so I have inherited this ministry from my predecessors and from leaders in the congregation of the church. We host this emergency warming center where we provide hospitality for folks who need a warm, safe place to rest in the coldest nights here in Walla Walla. And we, as the church, in our fellowship hall, we host this effort. But it's a team effort, and so the United Way and the county homeless coordinator coordinate the volunteers, and the volunteers are, I mean, like yourself, drawn from all kinds of different walks in Walla Walla, and actually some folks are formerly homeless themselves, some folks are from our congregation, some folks are from many other congregations or faith groups or no faith group at all. And so it's really quite a privilege for us to host guests and to provide sanctuary for folks who need sanctuary. And this, my understanding is, I said I inherited this. We've been open for 4 years now, I guess it is. But it started because an individual who was unhoused, who was pretty well known in the community, one bitterly cold night during a surprisingly cold winter, she died while sleeping on the doorstep of a church here in town.
Wow.
And so that sense of being so aware of the warmth that those of us with privilege to have a warm place to sleep, folks came together and remembered, well, Jesus had something to teach about this, and probably for a very good reason. And so folks, their hearts were broken and knew that, well, we have a roof and we have people of goodwill who want to help make this happen. And so it started out as just a kind of grassroots effort and folks figuring out how to make it happen, and it got much more kind of formalized, so now we're able to do it in a consistent way, in a way that is safe for everyone and legal and all these other considerations. But it is, the volunteers are the bread and butter of it, and so we're very grateful for just the outpouring of generosity in many ways from the community here.
And Kristen, can you tell us a little bit about your title and your place there and what you do for the Warming Center? And also, can you tell us a little bit about what the guests have when they come to the Warming Center? Because I noticed that they have a warm meal, mm-hmm. too. They have a warm place to sleep, a place to put their things. Maybe you can talk a little bit mm-hmm. about that.
Absolutely. I am the volunteer coordinator for United Way. So during the warmer months, I'm coordinating volunteers at different nonprofits with different programs and entities in our county, and some in Columbia County. So when this position of center coordinator for the Warming Center coordinator came open, it was a natural fit because United Way has had such a hand in creating this four-year opportunity in partnership with the county and with the First Congregational Church. So I'm there every night. Mm-hmm. I work with the volunteers as much as I can during the day, and then I'm there in the night to kind of triage the opening, which is usually a little bit more of an intense period because once they're in, they kind of settle down and rest a little. But Nathaniel mentioned our mission, which is to create a warm, safe, hospitable place to rest. And so as long as we can accomplish those things, our night is a success. It might look different every single night. some nights everybody might come in and do exactly as they're told, check in at the front, turn their personal belongings, much like when you're going through the airport, mm-hmm. You check your bags. We ask them to check their bags so that there's nothing illegal that's brought into the church or something that's dangerous, since that is one of our goals, is to keep them safe. And so they check their bags, and in exchange for their personal items, we give them bedding for the night. Now, they sleep on the floor. It is not a cot, like you see in some of those mm-hmm. those pictures that are heart rendering. It is on the floor with one or two blankets, no mm-hmm. pillow. It's very simple, but they are happy to be there, and we always let them know that we're happy that they're there, mm-hmm. and we usually get quite a few smiles. So once they're in, we try to make sure that they have some nourishment. That might be something as simple as a soup from a can. Mm-hmm. Occasionally we have different organizations that have commercial kitchens that bring in really nice food, and that's always a treat. The other evening I came in and I smelt grilled onions, which was a real treat. I don't know where they came from, but we were grateful. And you know, with the meal we try and have a little bit of something warm and something sweet. Sometimes having a little bit of sugar helps mm-hmm. get the energy back up after spending an entire day wearing out every single personal resource that they have to stay warm. Mm-hmm. So most often when they come in, they're very tired. Yeah. It's a very tiring day being outside, often doing things that don't appear to be fun to mm-hmm. those of us who have other things to do.
Thank you.
Yeah.
And Sierra, you know, I thought I was comfortable with giving you an introduction, but I kind of blew it there. Can you tell us your full, your name and your title there?
So my name's Sierra Knudsen, and I'm the homeless coordinator for the county under Community Health Department.
You did it much better than I did.
It's a big mouthful.
So can you, we just have a couple minutes, mm-hmm. I believe, before our break, though. Can you tell us, and we'll give you much more time here, mm-hmm. but can you just give us a rundown on, you know, what you do as your position mm-hmm. and how you tie into this?
My biggest position and goal is basically to support Kristen. She is probably the predominant person that kind of manages everybody, and when people are calling and saying, I can't make it in tonight, or I'm late, or I can't fill my shift, she's the gal that really is kind of our go-to. So my job is basically to support her and Nathaniel and the church. I provide a lot of support to the volunteers at the shelter just to kind of help them manage those challenging behaviors, just kind of addressing, you know, stuff can people say, things that are, you know, can be very upsetting and very challenging, to kind of help people navigate that. And then kind of more as the professional role through the county, it's mainly to coordinate the emergency management system so that we have that coverage for all of our volunteers, so they have insurance. So if they get in a wreck on the way there, they're covered, or if they fall while they're at the church, they're covered. And then really to make sure that then those other local agencies are aware as well, that when we open, so we're that kind of that upper kind of tier coordinating. But Kristen does the brunt of everything for the most part.
How would you describe the homeless situation in Walla Walla? I mean, where are we at in numbers?
Are you talking in shelter? Are you talking total numbers?
Well, you know, I went to the homeless camp mm-hmm. there, and there was, I think they were saying there was around 42 mm-hmm. people living there, mm-hmm. like right now, mm-hmm. in the middle of this winter.
Yeah.
What do you see as, what kind of numbers are we looking at in Walla Walla? Do we have a homeless problem?
I guess when I look at it is that I don't view homelessness as a problem inherently, because we kind of attach that problem to then the people, and then the people become the problem. Mm. I like to identify it more as that we have an economy problem. We don't have affordable housing. We don't have services that can support people who really need it. With the increase in the ACA insurance, we've seen kind of an explosion of need, but providers are kind of grappling to catch up. So I don't believe, when I talk to agencies across the U.S., everybody is struggling, whether it's, you know, large places like New York, clear down to little tiny towns that are 400 people. They're homelessness across the state.
We'll have to catch up in just a second. We're going to take a quick break. We thank you for joining us, and we hope this show that you're watching is a blessing and will inspire you to reach out to help somebody. Thanks for watching Valley Viewpoint tonight. On our second half, we're talking about the Warming Center, and with me is Nathaniel, Kristen, and Sierra, who all play a vital role in the Warming Center and helping with the homeless people of Walla Walla. We had to go to a break, so mm-hmm. I kind of cut you off little bit, but you were great. You kind of corrected me. It's not a homeless problem. I think that's great. It's the perspective sometimes, mm-hmm. and it's more about the economy, mm-hmm. housing, mm-hmm. and so when he was, was there anything else you wanted to add to that?
I think just in general numbers for what we see, Walla Walla has about 60 unsheltered individuals that are struggling with homelessness. And that has been really consistent for about the last 5 years when we trend each year. So I wouldn't say that we're getting worse, which is great, but we're not getting better. So we definitely have some improvement we need to work on. But overall, we're looking at some options for affordable housing that we can hopefully increase, and I think that'll make a big dent. And then as well as the community colleges and the other colleges are actually doing student housing as well, which will also help increase those opportunities for housing. So we're getting there.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I went to the homeless camp, mm-hmm. which is several tents out mm-hmm. in the snow, but it looks like the city is helping out. It looks like mm-hmm. there's some electrical and there's some water, mm-hmm. and mm-hmm. a lot of people have been helping out, mm-hmm. donating wood and things mm-hmm. like that, mm-hmm. but it's still incredibly cold out there. It's mm-hmm. been such a brutal winter and mm-hmm. such painful. I did hear that one gentleman had suffered some frostbite mm-hmm. on his toes. Mm-hmm. It's a struggle. The people get sick out there, mm-hmm. and so it's tough. But I was able to talk to somebody that has actually been to the warming center, and they were very thankful that you guys are there for them. So, and I just want to, you know, I want to reiterate that the warming center, unfortunately, was unable to open because of a lack of volunteers. And so I just, I hope that our viewers know that, that we have this warming center and that it's a very wonderful cause, and that, you know, we need to be supporting this. And it's not only with volunteers, but, you know, there's some monetary things there too that can be equally as helpful. You know, not everybody can, you know, donate time at night, but they could certainly help you with this cause. And I think it's a very important cause. And I think that, you know, we're a Christian television station, and I think, as you had mentioned earlier, this is very, this is what we should be doing. This is what we should be doing. It's a very good cause. So, what can you, what else can you tell us?
Well, so the, I mean, first of all, our volunteers are wonderful, outstanding. And this has been a unprecedented winter. We open our warming center. It's not a warming shelter. You know, we would need a different facility for it to properly be a shelter to shelter folks in a longer term kind of way. And so we're only open under really quite cold circumstances, 25 degrees if there's precipitation, 20 degrees if there's not precipitation. So it's a it's an emergency stopgap kind of thing. And it takes some really dedicated volunteers who, we need volunteers to show up at 1 a.m. and four in the and take shifts, you know, 3 hours each. And so we got to the point in this last cold snap and snow storm where our volunteers were tapped out. And so it was really quite heartening, because then the call went out. We got it together to have another training for some folks like yourself, some fresh blood. Hope you're feeling well rested from your shift.
Almost.
And what was it, 40, 50 people came? It was outstanding. And so so that'll get us through tonight. It seems like it'll warm up again for a week, and then we'll see. We'll the call will go out for some more volunteers if we have the need, and we'll see. Hopefully not. And in the meanwhile, I mean, certainly financial donations through the United Way will help pay for the heating and for other day-to-day supplies. Probably at this, I'll let you speak to that, but at this point, that's probably our pressing need.
So one thing you asked me earlier is when we do open, which is 20 degrees and below, which if anybody has been in Walla Walla these last couple of weeks, that has been where we've been at.
So that kind of creates an emergency scenario.
Yes. So that's considered dangerously cold. And very rarely is someone fully prepared to stay outside for that. And that's why we see folks come in with frostbite and cold-related injuries at the center. So as far as the volunteers go, and closing that one day was heartbreaking. It was also very, very encouraging to know that the community was able to rally behind us and, and reopen and bring in new forces. And that was good, but very heartbreaking for those of us who have been keeping it open as best we can. This long haul, I keep calling it a long haul, but it's the longest period that the warming center has been open since the beginning of its time 4 years ago. So it's a very cold winter, which is depleting the volunteers that are there very regularly. Some of them are retired, and so they assure me that it's okay to be up all night and then to nap during the day. But I know better, and I know that to appreciate them is my best best way of returning the favor.
And they don't have to be there all night. The shifts are about 3.5 mm-hmm. hours. So yeah. mm-hmm. so that's a pretty doable mm-hmm.
yeah.
chunk of time. Mm-hmm. You're not missing a whole night's sleep. It's,
yeah.
you know.
Yeah.
Also, Nathaniel, we were talking when you were out of the room, uh-huh. and we were talking about how many, you have a lot of events. The First Congregational Church does a lot for the community that I'm learning, and it's really wonderful, your outreach. Can you tell us how many things do you have going on a daily basis? What kind of things go on at that church?
Well, we host recovery groups, AANA, Al-Anon, and the like, morning, noon, and night, and that's been going on for quite a while. And it's a very strong community of folks then who, well, have a lot of ownership of the church mm-hmm. and take good care of the church. And that has continued to happen as we open the Warming Center, and folks are good-natured about it. There's some juggling that needs to happen sometimes. And then we have a couple of other community groups mm-hmm. that use the space on a weekly or biweekly level, as well as then our own ministries. I mean, our Sunday services and Wednesday night services. So it's a lively place.
Yeah. So, can you tell us about how maybe whoever would like to answer this question? I got two questions. How has it stretched you? Because, you know, for me, going there last night, I was, I was meeting a lot of different characters, a lot of different personalities. Mm-hmm. And it was definitely stretching me a little bit. But it was great. You know, there's a lot of great people there mm-hmm. that need help. I mean, so how is this stretching you? Is it, you know, is this adding something to your life?
Oh, absolutely. I find it adds in so many different aspects. The volunteers and the stories that they share with me, some of them have experienced homelessness, and having that aspect and then having them come give back, it renews my faith in humanity. Where it's like, when I think we're really struggling and we're really having a hard time right now, and these people show up, you know, nothing benefiting them other than just to be here is amazing. And then the gratitude that I have every night when I think I've got a warm shower, I've got a warm bed, my life is not that hard.
Yeah.
Yeah. Every evening when I walk into my house where it's warm, I've got like 5 layers on and I'm pretty cold, but I'm thankful. Mm-hmm. And when I'm at the Warming Center, I'm thankful for each and every one of those volunteers. Mm-hmm. Because when you come in out of the cold and you have been out in it all day, you are cranky. You're not your best self. And so sometimes those super kind, sweethearted volunteers are called all manner of things that aren't true. But it still sticks sometimes, and you have to shake it off. So every single one of the volunteers are stretched, mm-hmm. And outside of their own personality, because it's easier just to be nice when people are nice to you. Mm-hmm. But sometimes you have to be nice to people that aren't exactly the nicest to you. But you can earn respect, and that can change. Mm-hmm. But it's a surviving group of people that live mm-hmm. outside, and so they are surviving different things than we are, and so mm-hmm. they respond to kindness different. Mm-hmm. They respond to the way that they're treated a lot differently. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. It was so, when I went down to the homeless camp to take some video, my bare hands were out there and they were just freezing. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we've gone down there to help and deliver some things, and mm-hmm. the icy weather was just biting at my face, mm-hmm. and I had anxiety mm-hmm. that people were living there. Mm-hmm. It was really, I don't know if I could do it. It's tough. And I would, you know, ask our audience, could you go live in this? I mean, think about it, mm-hmm. living in these icy conditions. And so this is a time to outreach. This is a very mm-hmm. important time to outreach. Mm-hmm. So let's say somebody wants to help. Okay, so right now you might have enough volunteers, but you know, we'll just leave that at that at the moment because you had a nice showing. But tell us, is there a number or a website, email that somebody can get a hold of you and find out how they might be able to help?
So the volunteers are coordinated through the United Way office. Traditionally, we train them in the fall before the cold weather hits. The Warming Center is open officially November 1st through the end of February as a period of the coldest point of the year. So we try to do our trainings before that, before we're really busy. So that's the time to be looking for advertisements for volunteer opportunities. You can always call the United Way office or email me, and I'm assuming we can have that across the screen.
Yes.
So that would be available to them, and they can call anytime, any time during the year, and I would be happy to connect them with ways to get involved with this population.
Okay.
Yeah. And certainly financial donations, welcome and and needed through the United Way, that's preferable, but also to the church marked for the Warming Center. And on the daily, warm socks and blankets will always go to use.
Yep. We will always be on the running out end of those.
That's right. That's right.
Well, I'm afraid that wraps it up. I want to thank you so much for what you do, for your leadership and your being a role model for this community and helping out people in need. And I just want to appeal to you who are watching. You know, when you step outside and you feel that biting cold, I want you to remind yourself that there is a homeless camp here with about 42 people living out in this cold condition. And when you go inside your home, I hope you're thankful for the warm air, for the warm shower that you have, and think about those that don't have that. And thank you for watching Valley Viewpoints tonight and or today, and we just appreciate you and hope this has been a blessing to you.